We are slowly working our way down the OSI layers, and we are now at layer 2, and we are at the data link layer, also known as the network access layer in TCP/IP, remember when we compared those two? So let's talk a bit about the data link layer, layer 2. It packages our packets into frames. Remember I was talking about encapsulation as it works its way down? It's going to go from a segment to a packet, and now we're at the frame level. So each time we have a little bit more data that has been added and a little bit more header information. So now we're at the lowest of the levels before we hit the physical layer. So we are talking about frames at this point. Our protocol data unit, our PDU at this point, is called a frame. So there's two sublayers in the data link layer. They are the logical link control, which is LLC, and media access control, the MAC. But it's not the same as the MAC you're thinking of that I've referred to. So there's two layers in that we'll discuss. So the logical link control layer, the LLC, it identifies which protocol is used for the frame and places an identifier into the frame. So it identifies the protocol. Media access control provides data link layer addressing. So that's where we start getting, how do I communicate to the other location across this physical link on this bus? And it does delimiting of data according to the physical signaling needed by the media that we're transmitting across. So it determines how we're going to handle that. So we'll put down here, just put addressing. So for each link along the way, let's draw out a little network here. For each link between these, we could have a different physical connection, right? So this could be copper. It's copper Ethernet. This might be fiber. And this might be some other kind of copper, or let's just pretend this is wireless. So we have three different kinds. If a piece of data needs to get from here over this connection, and then from here over this connection, it has to know how to traverse these two different types of connections. That's what the data link layer does. So the descriptions in the data link layer protocols, they define how to communicate across these links, and they can change from link to link to link. So we might be talking IP in layer 3, and that's going to be traversing any sort of media that we have. That's what the data link layer does for us. So it doesn't matter from connection to connection, it can change drastically. We could have 10 megabit copper over here and 10 gigabit fiber over here, and 54 megabit wireless A, 802.11a over here, something like that, whatever it might be. It'll change from link to link, and that's how we differentiate those layers. Is we can talk IP, but we don't care what's below it. If we cared what's below it, then we'd have to have some sort of different protocol for every single connection, and why we do that, but not at the logical connection, at the physical connections, we have different protocols that define how to communicate across that link, and the upper layers don't care about it. That's how we're able to efficiently traverse different types of connections without needing to get too many details involved in doing so. So it encapsulates and de-encapsulates as it goes down and up those layers. Remember, as we were talking about routing a little bit, and how we end up stripping off layer 2 to read layer 3 and see where it goes, and then strips off layer 2. And so each time, when it strips off that layer 2 header to look at layer 3 to see where it needs to route, it's then going to re-encapsulate that data with whatever type of header information it needs to traverse that link. So that's also a beneficial thing to needing to strip off layer 2 each time, is because we need to rebuild it every time. So not only are we inspecting each hop of the way, but we're also stripping off layer 2 so that we can rebuild it for whatever type of connection might come next. Standards-wise, we talked about different standards groups before. So the upper layer protocols are usually handled by like the IETF. The physical layer type engineering, we've mentioned that that's handled by the IEEE. The Institute for Electrical and Electronics Engineers. There's also other groups out there. The International Telecommunications. The ITU, Telecommunications Union, and I won't write out all of them, but the International Organization for Standardization, we've talked about them already with the OSI model, remember them. And the American National Standards Institute, so ANSI, they have some play in this as well. So there's a bunch of different organizations out there, depending on what part of the world you're in or what kind of communication you're using, that have defined different physical specifications. So in the header, let's take a look at some header information. So now that we're talking data link, we need to take a look add some header info. I'm going to capture a little bit of data. I'm going to go somewhere. There we go. And we've got a couple packets. Okay. So let's take a look at some layer two. We'll go check out this one. You note here in Wireshark, we have we've been going from top down, so we've been going from layer 7 down to 1. When you look at this list here, it goes in reverse. So this is layer 4, layer 3, layer 2, you get the idea, so it goes up. So let's take a look at our Ethernet frame. So here's some information about that. Not only does it have some frame information for us, but it then also breaks down some additional info about what type of frame we're doing. So here's some information about our frame on layer 2. We've talked about IP, we've talked about transport layer. In here we have some information about the start of the frame, the end of the frame, we have what kind of encapsulation type it is, how long is the frame, what protocols are in the frame, and then there's also some stamped information here as well. If we go in and look into the Ethernet information within this frame, we see we have a destination and a source address, as well as what type of layer 3 is inside. So it not only defines how do we get to the next device on this local link, but also what's up the chain, so it knows what protocol to hand this off to next. So the destination and the source address are very important. These are the MAC addresses that we need in order to communicate over Ethernet from one device to another. And this was much more important back in the original design of Ethernet. I mentioned before it was a bus. So Ethernet's based off of a bus methodology where you could technically have a whole bunch of computers interconnected with just copper, no smart technology involved with switches or anything like that. And that back then was called hubs. So a hub was basically a physical interconnection of those wires. So from a logical design standpoint, all these computers were just connected on one big trunk. They were all interconnected to each other. So if you send a frame out onto the line, you need to have some way of knowing who to go discuss, who you're talking to. If you just send it out onto the frame, onto the line, well, there could be 8 other computers out there that might receive it and interpret it, and you might not want that to happen. So that's where this media access control comes in, because once it gets to this copper, it needs to know who I'm sending it to, and anyone else who sees it, who's going to receive this, well, please ignore it if this is not your MAC address. That's the idea behind this. Now we have switches almost pervasively throughout all networks, so even in homes. So if your computer needs to send a frame, most likely it's going to be on a dedicated connection directly to a switch, and we'll talk about why that is good. it's not as much of an issue, but on some types of networks, you know, you still need to have that, especially, you know, with wireless, for example. So there's still some reasons to have this out there, but this is the idea behind the MAC addressing, is you need to have some sort of address to send your frame to, because we already have an IP address on layer 3, so that's logical. But physically on this connection, you know, how do I get there? And this is how I get there. And this can change as you go from link to link. Remember, the layer 3 IP address information, unless we start talking about NAT later on, this essentially will stay the same. And the only thing that will change is your layer 2. So the layer 2 address will change. So this is going from my network card to my switch, and then this will go, at this point this will then be stripped off, and then a new layer 2 will be built, and it will be from my switch to my router, and then it will be stripped off, and then the router will put his own stuff in there and say from my router to his next hop, and so on and so on and so on. And that's how it defines how we're going to get from one device to another on this link. There's also some information here on, we could do flow control, as we mentioned before, we can do that in layer 2, congestion control and things like that, and some quality of service as we've mentioned. So, at the end of the trailer, there's a trailer at the end of this I've mentioned, since we're here, there's that CRC value, cyclic redundancy check, and it places that a value in the frame check sequence field, which defines, you know, if you basically, it's a hashing of in a way. So it'll take this frame, it will run it through the meat grinder. Remember, I mentioned that, and it will come up with some sort of value. And then another device will receive the frame, it'll run it through its meat grinder and see if that value matches. If it matches, then it will be then it will be a valid frame, and it will process it. If it doesn't match, then it knows that it's been corrupted, and it will handle it appropriately, most likely dropping it. So some common protocols for layer 2. We see some of them here. We have Ethernet. That's one of our protocols on layer 2. We also have ones such as point-to-point protocol, wireless, 802.11 wireless. There's many others out there as well. But let's go back to our whiteboard, and we'll talk a bit more about this with ARP and such as well. So let's go back to our whiteboard. So we have some different protocols. Let's scribble these down. So protocol wise, we have Ethernet, very common. We have point-to-point protocol, so that's PPP. We also have 802.11 wireless. And this is not an exhaustive list. I mean, there are tons and tons of them. We have, what else? We have HDLC, high-level data link control. So we have HDLC. We'll talk about that later on. We have frame relay, which is another still popular protocol, where we actually, quote, relay the frames from one location to another. And then there's a bunch of others too. But you know, here's a basic list. So in the Ethernet frame, it's the most common. This is 802. It's starting to sound familiar, right? All these 802 numbers. Remember I was talking about this, how IEEE is really involved with all these things? So we have 802.2 and 802.3. Are the IEEE specifications for Ethernet, and they've been around for a very long time. It supports all sorts of speeds. I mean, they keep updating it every couple of years too. So original specification was 10 megabits per second. We now have 100 megabits per second, which came out not too long afterwards. You have half duplex and full duplex versions. The original specification was half duplex, then we had 100 megabit full duplex. Now we have 1 gigabit, which can also be half duplex. We have 1 gigabit per second now, which is full duplex only. And now we have 10 gigabits, even over copper. So has the ability to be upgraded with faster and faster speeds, and you know, be on the lookout for even faster going forward. A lot of homes now and small businesses are switching over to 1 gigabit per second links, but you will find a ton of 100 megabit out there still. Especially a lot of Cisco equipment was a little bit price prohibitive on going to full gigabit for their switches up until recently. So you'll see a whole lot of Cisco gear out there that still runs at 100 meg in businesses. We have a point-to-point protocol used to deliver between two nodes. So this is specific. Ethernet was the bus technology, remember? So we have a whole bunch of things interconnected on one bus. Point-to-point is literally just one to another. So often used on like serial connections, which we'll go through at the end of our video series here. We'll start talking about WAN connections. So this is often used for like serial WAN type connections directly from one device to another, and it's simpler because there's less header information needed too, because you don't have to do as much addressing and processing. It's defined in RFCs though. It's not a IEEE standard, it's an IETF RFC type document, and uses logical connections between nodes to separate them from physical architecture. So it's a logical definition of the point-to-point connection. We also have 802.11 wireless, which is very important. That's become huge nowadays. It uses the same 802.2 specification, which is our LLC specification, and it enhances that with the 802.11 specs for the specifics of wireless, but it uses both. So it uses the same 48-bit addressing scheme as other LANs. You know, wireless connections, they have that same type of, they look similar. So if we go take a look, for example, you know, it'll still have that same connection. I guess I don't have a wireless on here. But even virtuals, they'll have similar type connection information. Yeah, I don't have one on here. I thought I did. Oh well. But yeah, you'll have the same physical address type definition on wireless as you do with a standard Ethernet wired connection. One difference with wireless, though, is, which we'll get into, is it uses CSMACA instead of CD. Ethernet uses CD. And you're going to say, what does that mean? So this is carrier sense multiple access collision avoidance. And then we have carrier sense multiple access collision detection. So with Ethernet, because it's on a copper or fiber connection of some kind, you can detect when there's a collision of a frame. So if someone's talking at the same time as somebody else, you'll see, you know, a jolt in voltage or a drop in voltage, or, you know, not the correct wavelengths of light or something like that. You can detect what that happens. With wireless, you can't really detect that very well, if at all. So what they have to do is avoid collisions as much as possible. So by design, wireless is slower than Ethernet over some sort of wired connection because it uses CSMACA instead of CD, because there's more waiting to see if someone else is talking. So that it's an inherent slowness to wireless, based upon this need to not be able to detect collisions but avoid them. And it does so by doing a random backoff timer, which we also have in Ethernet, but it's not as much of an issue, because now that we have switches everywhere, which we'll talk about, collisions really don't happen very often because not everyone's on one bus like we've discussed. Now everyone has a direct link into some sort of switch, and the switch doesn't allow the collisions to really happen. But with wireless, it's just open airwaves, so you can have a lot of collisions there. So what it does is it uses a random backoff timer, and if someone is talking, there'll be a randomized backoff timer where everyone waits for a certain period of time, which is randomized, and then they'll wait that period of time before they try to talk again. That waiting slows down wireless. So that's the reason for that, and that's the difference. HDLC we'll get into a little bit later, and frame relay we'll get into a little bit later as well, so we won't go into that too much. But that's the basics of some data link layer operations and protocols that are used. From here, we're going to go into physical layer. So now that we've gotten down to layer two, we're going to get down into layer one and a little bit about signaling and some of the specifications related around that and how the encoding works and such.